Hey, welcome to EPN. My name is Victor Lucas, and we bring you the latest in everything cool every single day. We've got a great rundown for you today, and it's dedicated to our friend NintendoBoy17. He said, hey, Vic, Octopath Traveler is going multi-platform. You called it. I did call it, but that game was such a big hit, pretty easy to see. Let's get started with your rundown. A short time ago in a galaxy far, far away called Chicago, Bothan spies uncovered some new details about Star Wars Episode 9. Earlier today at the Star Wars Celebration, Disney unveiled the first teaser trailer for the new film, which shall henceforth be known as Star Wars Episode 9, The Rise of Skywalker. It's unclear which Skywalker the title is referring to, although we do know that Mark Hamill will be back as Luke, and he's not the only apparently deceased character making a return. The trailer also reveals for the first time that actor Ian McDiarmid will be back as the villainous Emperor Palpatine, along with what appears to be pieces of one of the destroyed Death Stars. Surviving character Lando is back as well, and the film will be using deleted footage of late actor Carrie Fisher from The Force Awakens and The Last Jedi to build new scenes around her character, Leia. Also at the panel, Disney unveiled a new droid character named Dio, a cute companion for BB-8 that will no doubt sell a lot of toys. Episode 9, The Rise of Skywalker, hits theaters this December, but it might be the last Star Wars movie we get for a while. Speaking with Bloomberg Television, Disney CEO Bob Iger has reiterated his position that the Star Wars movies need to take a break after Episode 9, something he first stated after the poor box office performance of last year's Solo.
Thought we were in trouble there for a second, but it's fine. We're fine.
That means it will be at least a few years before we start seeing new movies, so hopefully Episode 9 will satisfy until then. Oh man, I'm getting so excited. I can't wait to see more. I'm going to do everything I can to not watch more trailers, though. I just want to see this movie as it plays out before me. I want to be as surprised as possible, so maybe we'll stop covering Star Wars on Electric Playground. Yeah, right. Over on the small screen, Disney has just launched a major offensive in their quest for global domination. They've announced that their new streaming platform, Disney Plus, will launch November 12th and will cost just $7 US per month, undercutting their biggest competitor, Netflix. Unlike many other streaming services, it won't be limited to the US at launch and will instead be available in the US and Canada simultaneously, with Europe and Asian territory set to follow soon after. As part of the announcement, Disney also confirmed loads of exclusive content for the platform. A new Marvel animated series called What If, which imagines alternate versions of stories and characters, is on the way. It will start with an episode imagining what if Agent Carter had taken the Captain America strength serum instead of Steve Rogers. Disney has also officially confirmed the existence of live-action Marvel shows like the Loki series starring Tom Hiddleston, the Scarlet Witch series with Elizabeth Olsen, and the Falcon and Winter Soldier Buddy series with Anthony Mackie and Sebastian Stan. For Star Wars fans, Disney revealed that the Rogue One prequel show starring Diego Luna as Cassian Andor will also see Alan Tudyk return as his robotic companion K2SO. And on top of that, every single Star Wars movie will be available on the platform. Finally, the most surprising announcement is that all 30 seasons of The Simpsons will be available on Disney Plus at launch. Disney just got the rights to the franchise during their acquisition of Fox, and until now, the only way to stream the show has been through the FX website, which, incidentally, is now owned by Disney as well.
I, for one, salute our new corporate overlords.
And as predicted, this is a huge announcement for Disney, and their stock is surging, and a lot of people have kind of shifted their attention, very much like in Up, where Doug sees the squirrel. It's like, squirrel? You know, people are very, very excited about this whole new wave of Disney content that is coming our way. Surprised to see this Falcon and the Winter Soldier. I always want to say Falcon and the Snowman. That was that Timothy Hutton movie and Sean Penn. Nobody knows what I'm talking about. It was a great movie, but every time I hear Falcon and the Winter Soldier, I want to say Falcon and the Snowman. But I'm super psyched about that because Falcon and the Winter Soldier had excellent chemistry in Captain America and in the Avengers, so I think this is going to be a lot of fun. I'm just excited for all of these actors who have portrayed these superheroes and these characters with great skill, and they've embodied them with a great human touch, and they're just fun actors. So I think it's going to be awesome to see Elizabeth Olsen. I know the Vision is going to be in there. I think the show is called WandaVision, which is a very weird name for a show, but I think that's going to be cool too, with Scarlet Witch and the Vision together. I think that's going to be so much fun. Disney Plus is going to have a huge, huge hit on their hands immediately, and if the quality is up to our expectations, it's going to blow people away. So don't let us down, Disney. On a rival streaming service, there's a new Batman in the house. Well, sort of. The DC Universe streaming show Titans has unmasked their version of Gotham's most famous do-gooder. Game of Thrones actor Ian Glenn has been cast as Bruce Wayne, the billionaire philanthropist who, spoiler alert, is the alter ego of the Caped Crusader Batman. He'll be introduced as Bruce Wayne in the upcoming second season of the show, although it's unclear how much we'll be seeing of him in the Batsuit or just how heroic he might be. We do know that Ian Glenn is 57 years old, which means he'll be playing an older Bruce Wayne opposite the show's main character, Brenton Thwaites, as the boy wonder Robin. Season 2 is currently filming and will start streaming this fall.
Fuck Batman.
Very cool casting here. Ian Glenn is awesome on Game of Thrones. He's tortured all the way through that show and still got that jawline. He's got a great jawline for Cowl, just saying, as Bruce Wayne. It's very interesting, and I like Brenton Thwaites' Dick Grayson, so I'm excited to see the chemistry of these two.
Fuck Batman.
To see how the sparks fly off of each other, because I think there is a lot of anger, a lot of heat.
Fuck Batman.
Lots of feelings of being let down or forgotten or betrayed. So I think we're going to see some explosive stuff in the second season of Titans. Titans really grew on me, too. It's a great show. Definitely a crown jewel in the DC Universe streaming service, which I hope comes to Canada very soon. Keep it coming, DC Universe. Very, very excited about this news.
Fuck Batman.
Over to a different kind of streaming service, Microsoft wants to rain on Google's cloud streaming parade. Microsoft is not impressed with what Google has to offer with their new cloud-based game streaming platform, Stadia. Speaking with British tabloid The Telegraph, Xbox Chief Marketing Officer Mike Nichols says that although Google has the technical infrastructure to implement cloud streaming, they just don't have the games. This means he doesn't think Google will have enough exclusive titles to woo players to the service and is instead relying on third-party developers like Ubisoft and Bethesda. Xbox head Phil Spencer said something similar after Stadia's announcement, saying bluntly that Google had no big surprises. Microsoft, on the other hand, already has plenty of big first-party game franchises and development studios, which will come in handy when they launch their rival platform, Project xCloud. Some users would point out that the lack of exclusive first-party content is what hurt Microsoft's own Xbox One during its launch, so we'll have to wait and see if Stadia has similar problems. Both Stadia and Project xCloud roll out this year, and this is really the big test for Microsoft at this point, isn't it? They've got to show that they're investing in lots of exciting and finished and polished first-party titles that make us all want to rush to that platform. I think Microsoft is kind of hedging their bets on non-exclusivity. I think they're going to see the Project xCloud service roll out across a lot of different screens. I wouldn't be surprised if it's on the Switch. I wouldn't be surprised if they try to work out something with Sony. I would be surprised if Sony lets them do that. But I think we're going to see Project xCloud all over the place. And if their bets pay off and they do pick the right teams to make the right games, we've got a very exciting horse race out there. And I think it's going to be potentially a dynamic shifting one. It's going to be a very different dynamic than that traditional, you know, Nintendo versus Sega, Xbox versus Sony. Even though Google's a massive juggernaut, I wouldn't count Microsoft out against Google in this race. And I am waiting to see when Amazon lifts the veil off of whatever they're working on, because I'm sure Amazon is going to have some kind of streaming portfolio as well as related to games. Very interesting days ahead of us. After a big budget blunder with The Mummy, Universal Pictures is taking a smaller approach with their monster movies. The studio has gone back to the drawing board with their plans to create an interconnected series of monster movies revolving around classic characters like Dracula and Frankenstein. Rather than making the film's big-budget action-centric tentpoles like the failed 2017 Mummy movie, the new plan is to instead make smaller, low-budget movies with a more traditional horror tone. Universal is partnering with low-budget horror producer Jason Blum and his Blumhouse Productions and starting from scratch. The first film out of the gate will be a new version of H.G. Wells' The Invisible Man, directed by Saw co-creator Lee Wan, and starring Elizabeth Moss, who recently appeared in another Blumhouse movie, Jordan Peele's Us. That begins shooting soon, and if it's a success, expect more Universal Monster movies to follow. This is an excellent idea. Jason Blum has had some incredible success going small, freaking us out with his approach and also his stable of collaborators and co-creators, and he's made a nice series of provocative films out there, and I think this is absolutely the right way to legitimize and contemporize the Universal monsters, which are fantastic properties, fantastic characters, and frankly, you don't have to hire Tom Cruise, you know, and throw him as Tom Cruise into a picture that there was no fit. And that Mummy movie, I've still got scars from that Mummy movie. It was terrible. And I'm sure Tom Cruise still has scars from that Mummy movie. So this new direction, I applaud, and hopefully we'll be surprised, but more than anything, incredibly entertained. So good luck with that, Universal Pictures. All right, you guys, that's going to do it for our rundown today. Thank you so much for watching. We're going to be back on Monday with a brand new EP Live for you at 4:30 p.m. Pacific, and you can watch it in person at 390 West Hastings in Vancouver, B.C. at the VFS Cafe, or you can watch it on the stream here. Our guests are going to be Sam Kennedy and James Milkey talking about their brand new game called Jupiter and Mars. I can't wait for that conversation. It's going to be a lot of fun. Have yourselves an incredible weekend, and remember, play forever.